Today we have our postdoctoral fellow, Lerna Ekmekcioglu, to talk to us about Armenians in Istanbul. You see the title over there. Lerna is a very special person because she's a great scholar and too humble for her own good. I have complained about this to her, and hopefully this is an issue that will be resolved. Lerna comes to us from Istanbul, Turkey. She did her PhD at New York University. After a BA in sociology at Boğaziçi in University in Istanbul in 2002, and then a master's at New York University in 2004, and just this year, May, she got her PhD from the Near Eastern Studies Department in NYU. Her dissertation, Improvising Turkishness, Being Armenian in Post-Ottoman Istanbul, was supported by numerous grants, such as the American Association of University Women, International Fellowship, the NYU Humanities Initiative, the American Research Institute in Turkey, and she has published already in the Journal of Armenian Studies and co-edited a volume in Turkish focusing on the history of Turkish Armenian feminist writers at the turn of the 20th century. She speaks Armenian, Turkish, modern and Ottoman, and Greek, and she has conducted research in Istanbul, Yerevan, Beirut, Athens. So you see, at this very tender age, she has accomplished two things: great scholarship and two beautiful, gorgeous little girls. Thank you. Lerna, please welcome Lerna.
Thank you, Professor Libardian, and also all other members of the Armenian Studies program for offering me this postdoctoral fellowship. It's going very well, and also for providing me the opportunity to share my research findings with you today. The talk today will have three parts. First, I'll introduce my research, then I will move to the content of of today's talk, which will revolve mostly about on the post-1923 Armenian community in Istanbul, and then I will conclude with a few broader remarks. If I had to narrow down my research to one single question, I guess I would say it is the following. How did the first generation of Armenians, first generation of survivors, manage to continue living in Turkey after the 1915 Armenian genocide and after the 1923 establishment of the Turkish Republic? In other words, how did this minority, I asked to myself, how did this minority find a way to continue living among a people and under a regime who had first committed a genocide against them and then denied it? In order to answer these questions, I focus on Armenian textual practices produced in Constantinople or Istanbul from October 1918, when the treaty, Mudros Treaty, was signed, until about a decade after the establishment of the Republic. I focus on the press, that is the Armenian press in Istanbul, not only because of the nature of my research question, but also because of the unfortunate unavailability of other sets of sources, such as ethnographies, state archives, and also the archives of the Armenian Patriarchate in Istanbul. I should also say that after 1922, no Armenian periodical started publication inside Turkish borders except in Istanbul, where approximately 70% of Turkish Armenian population was concentrated. So this is probably the most important reason for me to limit my study to Istanbul. And I should also add that in Istanbul, the Armenian population throughout the 20s and 30s was somewhere from 150,000 people to 70,000 people. It fluctuates. So my research is about public discourses, about standpoints, about worldviews, and about representations, and about institutional practices. What I do not study is the ways in which Turkish Armenians, in their daily lives, inside their households, or among their close friends, talked about or experienced the drastically changing conditions around them. This fascinating topic of study is awaiting its own researcher, historian, cultural anthropologist, or maybe ethnomusicologist. The historical subjects of my research belong to a select group of Constantinopolitan Armenians who took it upon themselves to write or speak on behalf of Turkish Armenians and about Turks, Armenians, or Turkish Armenians. This group includes lay and religious leaders, male and female intellectuals, professionals, journalists, social workers, poets, and writers. Okay. So after these introductory remarks, I will now move to the content of today's talk. Even though I will mainly focus on the post-1923 period, my research also covers, a significant portion of my research covers the 1918-23 period, what we call armistice years in Turkish mütareke yılları, in Armenian zinatatari dariner. This period, which I'm fascinated with, starts with the signing of the Mudros Treaty, and it is marked by the Allied occupation, both in Istanbul and most parts of what we now call Anatolia. So the defeat of Ottomans and the ensuing Allied occupation emboldened Armenians in Istanbul at this time period. And they pursued an openly anti-Turkish policy. Probably the most significant example, or the most telling example, is that Armenian Patriarch Zaven Deryeyan himself cut his ties with the Sublime Porte at this time period, and he went to Paris Peace Conference to support the Armenian delegation's territorial claims at Paris. So during this time period, both for Armenians, both outside Ottoman borders and inside Ottoman borders, there were two main goals. First, the establishment of the Greater United Armenia, and second, retrospective punishment of the perpetrators of the recent Armenian massacres. This is just a map showing different borders of Armenia at different time periods. So I just did this graphic thing here. Turkish Armenians of the time were in the same group. Just this is the summary of probably like half of my research. They were in the same camp. Turkish Armenians were in the same camp with the allies and with the Armenians abroad, and against what they very openly referred as the enemy, the Turk, a group, the other, camp of the other who deserves punishment. So I would be more than happy in the question and answer section to further elaborate if you have any questions about this time period, but I'm moving now to the second period. And the second period, as I see it, starts in September 1922, when the news of the Greek defeat in Izmir and the ensuing fire reach Constantinople. Armenians panic. They are anticipating that an imminent Turkish entrance to the city would unleash the Turkish mob, and they would also be massacred as their counterparts, Christian counterparts in Greece. Because Greeks and Armenians at the time, they were seen as the internal representation of the outer enemy. In order to escape this tragedy, many Armenians, especially intellectuals, the wealthy, and the politically active, left Constantinople in terror. We don't know the numbers. No one has done focused study on this, but it is estimated 50,000 people have left only in September and October 1922. The triumphant Turkish forces entered the city in November 1922. And Constantinople, as I see it, became Istanbul once again. Non-Muslim residents experienced little to no violence. However, Armenians and other minorities, mostly Greeks, who had left the country during or after the Turkish War of Independence, were later barred by the Turkish regime to re-enter Turkey, and their allegedly abandoned property was confiscated. The second major round of disappointment for Armenians worldwide came with the signing of the Treaty of Lausanne in 1923 between Turkey and the Allies. The treaty, usually considered a Turkish diplomatic victory, signified two things to Armenians. That one thing, actually, to Armenians, that they failed in both of their post-war goals. They were left with no greater Armenia or no national home for Armenians, and no punishment, no Western punishment of the perpetrators, because it an amnesty was issued, actually. And a few months later, after the Lausanne, Turkey was proclaimed a republic, therefore ending the already defunct Ottoman Empire. So despite their tiny numbers, in early Turkish Republic, non-Muslims were considered a significant threat to the well-being of the state. In 1927, non-Muslims made up about 2.5% of the overall 13 million Turkish population. The Turkish state cadres, determined not to repeat what they perceived as the mistakes of their Ottoman predecessors, tried their best to forbid their citizenry from pursuing, quote, a life of communities, cemaat hayatı, epitomized in the millet system. Instead, the goal, in the words of the Turkish Prime Minister İsmet İnönü, was to create a monolithic mass, yekpare kütle, as a new nation state, based on the ideal of a homogeneous population sharing the same culture, language, and history. The Turkish state engaged in a Turkification campaign, which intensified especially in the 30s, especially in the later 20s and throughout the 30s. This campaign went hand in hand with other Kemalist reforms, aiming to form a modern, secular, westernized, Western-oriented, and progressive nation, then conceptualized as the antithesis of its precedent, the corrupt, Islamic, superstitious, backward Ottoman Empire. The underlying assumption of these top-down reforms was that if the fashionable hats changed from fez to fedora hats, the minds inside would also eventually change. Similarly, the founding cadres of the Republic had a firm belief that the right policies and strategic social demographic engineering mechanisms could mold their ethnically diverse population into the new Turkish nation. In order to achieve this nationalizing goal, the Turkification policies were implemented to ensure the domination of Turkish ethnic identity in every aspect of life in Turkey. To give only a few examples, in the early Turkish Republic, non-Muslims and many times non-Turkish Muslims did not have the right to free travel, free association, and free speech. They were forced out of state-run enterprises and forced to speak Turkish in public. In 1934, all Turkish citizens had to acquire a Turkish last name. It is my argument that the Turkish-Armenian community, as we know it today, came into being in the early years of modern Turkey and is in response to assimilationist discriminatory Turkification policies. In order to survive in a Turkey which did not want to accept them as Armenians, these people crafted what I call communal survival strategies. They fashioned a novel Turkish Armenianness by spending their collective energy on various things such as cooperation, adaptation, selection, accommodation, camouflaging, manipulation, exploitation, and indirect, if not passive, resistance. On the one hand, Armenian intellectuals and notable figures embraced Turkification and aspired to Turkify. On the other hand, they fought back by promoting the continuation of the Armenian essence, as they saw it in mother tongue, customs, traditions, and religious beliefs and practices. For this purpose, they did create new heroes, such as Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, and reappropriated already existing ones, such as the mother tongue and church. The first political move that the Turkish Armenians strategized immediately after the Turkish Kemalists' entrance to Istanbul was to drive out their patriarch Zaven, who represented anti-Turkishness. Simultaneously, the patriarchal cadres began engaging in an extremely pro-Turkish discourse and program. It is my understanding that it was the people with ties to the Armenian patriarchate who first crafted those communal survival strategies, mainly in order to ensure Armenian security, safety, survival in Turkey. The goal was to stay put and to safely cohabit with the majority. As the Turkification policies intensified, many, if not all groups within the Turkish Armenian intelligentsia adopted the patriarchate position simply because they had to, as I will further discuss in my lecture today. So the challenge, they had a significant challenge ahead of them. How they were going to, I mean, given their openly anti-Turkish activities and agendas in the armistice years, how were the Armenians to convince the victorious Turkish forces that if allowed to continue living in Turkey, they were going to remain loyal Turkish citizens? In order to achieve this goal, Armenians became extremely vocal in their expressions of loyalty to the state, especially to its leader Mustafa Kemal. They considered Mustafa Kemal their hero, who came to save the country, including its Armenians. In order to be sufficiently persuasive, Armenians discursively, that is Turkish Armenians, discursively distanced themselves from three categories that represented the past antagonism between Turks and Armenians. These were the Western powers, Armenians abroad, and the recent massacres. As we see, Turkish Armenians purposefully changed sides. And here are some examples to underscore this premise. As early as December 1922, significantly during when Zaven Deryayan was being driven out from his duty, some members of the Patriarchate and influential members, together with a few intellectuals, Turkish intellectuals, established a society they called the Society for the Elevation of Turks and Armenians, Türk-Ermeni Teali Cemiyeti. Their stated goal was, quote, to build a peaceful and sincere relationship between the Turks and Armenians. In effect, the goal was to convince the Turkish majority of Armenians' gratitude for being allowed to continue living in Turkey. The society's discourse is important because it provides the first instances of tropes and cliches that Armenians later adopted in their tribute to the Turkish state. A press release that the society issued in 1924 is quite telling in many regards. I'm just going to focus on one aspect of this quote. And I quote, "It was with abhorrence that Turkish Armenians read the speeches of Mr. Lee and Mr. Philip in the French Senate, which were about the protection of their rights. Why are these respectable people protecting the rights of Armenians in Turkey? Are they securing their interest by using Armenians, a group that had always lost, except its honor, due to foreign intervention, which always caused damage?" They continue. "Gentlemen, no. We do not need your brokering. We are proud to live in Turkey under the magnificent Turkish flag. Unlike the Ottoman rule, the Republic of Turkey would not consider Armenians its stepsons. In an exemplary way, the Turkish state treats us as its own children. We do not have any complaints about the Turkish Republic that talks about treating all communities equally. Please leave us alone. Turkish Armenians do not anymore need your protection and intervention. If you want to serve humanity, we suggest you take care of your own immigrants." Notice that the piece acquires a strong language when it presents Armenians to have always lost. By accepting foreign intervention on their behalf. Therefore, the text creates an image of an Armenian who finally realized what grave mistake he made in the past for choosing Christian Western protectors over his local Muslim overlords. By emphasizing that unlike the Ottoman Empire, the Turkish state treats Armenians, or will treat them, as its own children, the text also communicates that Armenians are ready to accept the Turkish state as their fathers and its father, Atatürk, as their father, many times at the expense of their own fathers, simply massacred a few years ago. Moreover, by declaring Armenians as true children of the new republic, the text also communicates that Armenians wanted to cut their ties with faraway siblings. Indeed, the foreign influence referred to in this text also included Armenians who emigrated abroad before, during, or after the genocide, what we call now as Armenian diaspora. The question of why Istanbul Armenians purposefully othered diaspora Armenians is answered rather easily in order to show their unconditional acceptance of Turkish terms for safe Armenians' existence. But the question of how they did it reveals interesting answers. During the early Turkish Republic, Ankara remained guarded towards the Armenians abroad. It viewed even simple international efforts aiming to raise relief funds for the survivors of the genocide as nationalist conspiracies against the Turkish state. By making use of this antagonism, Armenians themselves, Turkish Armenians themselves, discursively produced a good Armenian versus bad Armenian dichotomy and placed themselves in the former. Here is an example. In October 1924, 1 year after the establishment of the Turkish Republic, when the Turkish newspapers accused Armenian komitacı groups of attempting to assassinate Mustafa Kemal, the Armenian Patriarchate sent a telegram to Mustafa Kemal, which appeared in Turkish newspapers. An Armenian daily called Aravot Morning, after expressing resentment that the telegram was sent only to the Turkish newspapers and not to Armenians, translated the Patriarchate telegram as the following. I'm just quoting one section from this telegram. Those Armenians who reside in Turkey detest the comitages of abroad and these kinds of factious mischief. The Armenians are invariably tied to the young Turkish Republic. In the Turkish parlance of the day, komitacı Armenians referred to Armenian Separatist Revolutionary Party members. Purposefully employing the term komitacı, thus legitimizing its usage for this context, the Patriarchate's telegram tries its best to carve out a secure and detached position for Turkish Armenians, who are represented as detesting the komitacı groups, komitacıs of abroad. Thus, the text situates Turkish Armenians alongside Turks and opposite Armenians abroad. A question that by now some of you are probably asking is whether such statements from the Patriarchate were representative of most Armenians' feelings. It is impossible to answer this question by examining contemporary Armenian texts. Since we do not have ethnographic studies of Turkish Armenians at the time, we do not know whether in their homes Armenians talked about such statements as nonsense, or whether they genuinely believed that the new republic had real promises for successful cohabitation with the majority. We should definitely remember that from 1925 to 45, Turkey was a single party regime where all opposition was suppressed. This was true not only with regards to Armenians, but also to other minorities and other groups such as feminists, Islamists, and leftists. To illustrate this, let's look again at the Patriarchate's letter. So I'm continuing with the same example. Aravot Daily, which translated the telegram from the Turkish newspapers, in the same article, added that the wording and the message of the Patriarchate telegram was very unfortunate. It continued. According to us, this telegram should have stated, Armenians detest the Armenian comitages of abroad and these kinds of mischief if they exist. This is because until now it has not been proven that the attempted assassination was conducted by the Armenians. Similar to us, all Armenians naturally feel deep in their hearts that the existence of such Armenian komitacı groups is a total fabrication. And our souls are the witnesses that Armenian political parties of abroad are solely occupied to satisfy our national necessities, and they don't even have the time to think about other things. End of quote. So according to the standards of the time, this paragraph could represent opposition to the Turkish state. First of all, it legitimizes the existence of Armenian political parties abroad by calling them as such and refusing to label them as komitacı. Second, it implicitly accuses Turkish groups, maybe even the Turkish state, as fabricating a lie. And it is indeed no surprise that Aravot, which in general might have had a similar non-conforming attitude, was closed down by the Turkish government in 1924, shortly after the publication of this article. Aravot, which started publication in 1918 in Istanbul, used to be the official publication of the National Liberal Party, Askai Nazlagan Gusak Tutyun. After its closing in 1924, the paper began publication under a new name, Marmara, which took quite a conformist stance, and it is incidentally still published in Istanbul today as Nor Marmara. Returning to the Armenians' potential or real attempts to assassinate Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, I should say that Turkish Armenians made good use of them by turning these instances into opportunities to express their untiring loyalty to the person of Atatürk and what he represented. In 1935, after Ankara discovered two Syria-based Armenian assassination plots against Atatürk, an Armenian weekly named Norhuz, New Hope, published its cover page fully in Turkish. About the big photo of Atatürk in Armenian, it read, "An attack against the persona of our admirable Atatürk is an attack against the heart of our republic." Underneath, written in Turkish, it said, "The Republic of Turkey will never die." It was indeed hardly an infrequent occurrence for Armenian periodicals of the time to showcase Atatürk's photo. But going back to the Norhuz example, why were these columns in an Armenian weekly in 1935 in Istanbul in Turkish? Because they were intended for the Turkish censorship bureau in particular and the Turkish population in general. The only reason that the journal included articles in Turkish was when Atatürk was glorified and his enemies cursed. One article in Turkish tried to educate Armenians in the ways in which they could become native citizens, hakiki vatandaş, harazat hayrenagit in Turkey, and they do translate vatandaş, citizen, as hayrenagit, not karakatsi at this point. This piece was written in Armenian and then translated to Turkish in the next issue. In the article, the writer encourages Armenians to use Turkish language and urges Armenians to embrace secularism, populism, and to support Atatürk's Republican Party fully. Another cover page featured a title in Turkish and stated that the weekly donated its revenue of the day to the Turkish Aeronautical Association. I would also like to highlight an article perhaps we might now think as extreme. In 1936, Norhuz published a news item entitled Türkoğlu Türkenk. We are Turk-born Turks, or we are full-bred Turks. In which it was reported that new scientific research had found that Armenians were, in fact, Turks. I believe even this kind of loyalist discourse would not be enough if Armenians failed to publicly make a case that they did not want to remember their recent past. How did Armenians accomplish the task of publicly distancing themselves from the memories of the recent massacres and deportations? And when I say memory, I'm not saying how they in their homes talked about, cried about it. But this is only one example. But in the Armenian press during the armistice years, we see these pictures, stories after stories about how Armenian women were raped, how the deportation routes they suffered and everything. So only 1 year before the establishment of the Republic, we see this in the Turkish Armenian publications in Istanbul. In a sharp contrast to the Armenian press of the armistice period, the Armenian periodicals after the establishment of the Turkish Republic do not even hint at the Ottoman Turkish state's attempt to kill Armenians en masse. In the early Turkish Republic, the Turkish state, as we all know, did not acknowledge its role in the wartime massacring of Armenians. Therefore, Armenian public figures of the time in early Turkish Republic had no choice but to publicly ignore or collectively forget that the actual perpetrators of the genocide and usurpers of the Armenian properties were now influential, powerful state actors in the Republic, such as ministers and parliamentarians. Moreover, the Turkish state officials willingly and purposefully embraced their predecessors who had ordered the Armenian deportation and massacres. On May 31, 1926, the Turkish Assembly passed a law granting property to the families of Ottoman leaders assassinated by the Armenians in the Operation Nemesis, the revenge killings. According to the legislation, their families, the families of the Turkish statesmen, would be given property that once belonged to the Armenians. Parliamentarian Recep Zuhtu Bey, later Soyak, a close confidant and the private secretary of Mustafa Kemal, said in the parliament, quote, "This is a strong warning message to assassins. You may execute a Turk through an assassination, but we will raise his offspring with your money so that tomorrow he will gouge out your eye and break your head." Given this openly hostile context, it is understandable that Turkish Armenians promoted amnesia with regard to recent massacres. I believe this promotion was meant to kill two birds with one stone, as it also invited the Turkish state to do the same and forget Armenians' open disloyalty during the armistice years. In order to convince the state that Armenians bore no resentment against Turks, some Armenians took serious measures. In June 1935, the Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer Company announced it was going to produce a film based on Franz Werfel's 40 Days of Musada, a 1933 novel based on the real experiences of a group of Armenians in southern Turkey during World War I who successfully rebelled against deportation orders and probable death. The Turkish government reacted harshly to this announcement, threatening that Turkey would not only ban the film but also the company's all of the company's productions. Ankara used all diplomatic means to facilitate Washington's intervention in the matter. In order to challenge the credibility of the novel, Turkish newspaper announced that Werfel, like Ambassador Henry Morgenthau, another influential witness to the Armenian massacres, was Jewish. Turkish Armenians joined this campaign. They, in the words of Soner Çağaptay, condemned the action of the Jews in exploiting regrettable incidents of the past to harm, quote, the brotherly feelings between Armenians and Turks, end of quote. Moreover, some Armenians held a meeting in the Pangaltı Armenian Church and, quote, from Soner Çağaptay, an effigy of the offending author was solemnly burned together with a copy of his book. Ultimately, the film was not produced. Now I will try to productively complicate the story I told thus far by focusing on resistance to Turkification. The fact that Armenians embrace Turkification does not mean that they willingly withdrew from what they considered as the core of their Armenianness. For many public leaders and intellectuals of the period, Armenian language and religion continued to epitomize the Armenian essence, that is to say, their crucial differences from the majority. I believe the memory of the recent massacres and past oppression offered a similarly significant ground in terms of the ways in which Armenians understood their presence in modern Turkey. In other words, Armenians resisted complete Turkification even while they were embracing it. But how? I will now turn to this topic of Armenians' active yet cryptic, often elusive resistance to enforced Turkification. Given our time constraints here, I will focus on mainly three categories: memory, mother tongue, and the church. There are others. In the 1920s and 30s, Armenians did not fully bury their past, even in the text produced for public consumption. The discourse of forgetting the past coexisted with another discourse that entailed selective remembering. Many periodicals of the time frequently referred to Armenians as a national people who had undergone great misery and violence. The Armenian nation was still perceived as the victim of brutal violence in the recent past, although no specific group was accused of having caused the Armenians' pain. When contributors to periodicals mentioned past traumatic experiences, they exclusively used the passive voice, not accusing anyone of causing the suffering and pain. Phrases such as the years of exile, quotes, our slaughtered nation, end of quote, were framed in such ways that if the reader did not know the recent history, she would not know the who, the when, or the why. Especially in the late 20s and early 30s, when Kemalism reached its peak, this subtle language became even more subtle, such as characterizing the Armenian nation as one that had cried a lot, or one whose spirit is mourning. The multiple ways in which the Armenian nation was identified as one that had recently been uprooted acted as rhetorical tools to keep the memory of the massacres and uprooting alive. Armenians were imagined as a diaspora nation, is, Pyrus, Vdaragan, different terminology, and phrases such as the following attest to that. Many times I would see phrases say, we are a nation scattered to all corners of the world, or our exiled, deported nation. Even in the absence of references to the reasons for the dispersion, the frequent usage of the Armenian ethno-diasporic vocabulary acted as a reminder of that unstated reason. I think even the missing columns in newspapers acted as a reminder of the unspoken reason for Armenian scatteredness, and they even acted as a form of mourning. Let's look at the following example together. It is very familiar for many of you probably. I'm just going to, this is a very typical missing column print Turkish-Armenian newspaper. This is a practice that Armenian newspapers outside of Turkey also, we also see it in those newspapers. So they would just basically try to find their missed relatives. One of them, for example, Norsabi Shalbasyan, originally from Murdachai, is searching for his son, Vainak, who might be in Greece. Elmas Antriasyan is also searching the relatives. Such examples demonstrate that even though the amnesia of Turkish Armenians was not chosen, but forced, Armenians had agency in deciding what to forget and how to remember. The various discursive representations of the nation as scattered, including the missing columns and the diasporic vocabulary, function as a way of indirect commemoration, especially significant for a victim group denied the right to mourn and to commemorate its massacred dead in public. Briefly on the role of mother tongue in Armenians' negotiations of a new ethnic presence in Turkey. In the 1930 issue of the Yedikule Armenian Surpurgic National Hospital Almanac, the Armenian patriarch of the time, Mesrop Archbishop Naroyan, published an article entitled "The Armenian Language and Its Instruction." In order to highlight the importance of this piece, and it's a 300-page volume, the cover page of the almanac showcased this image that you see. In the article, the patriarch argued that the teaching and learning of Armenian language was compulsory for every Armenian since, quote, language is the nation, end of quote. He invited his people to learn their mother tongue well and to use it more often, especially at home and with children. It was unacceptable for parents, according to him, to communicate with their children in what he says, foreign tongues, which of course included Turkish. Not surprisingly, the patriarch singled out mothers. Like sacred mother's milk, The child has to imbibe the charm of her nation's language through maternal love. It is the crucial responsibility of educated mothers to impress their beloved children with the marvelous language of Mashdot, the inventor of the Armenian alphabet. All those first impressions and those first maternal sensations, they are indelible and indestructible. I think it is significant that he uses the terms indelible and indestructible, which I read as a form of resistance. It was inside the well-protected walls of the Armenian household that the essence of the nation, that is its language, was going to be transmitted from mother to child, like the sacred breast milk, without which babies cannot survive. I believe the editors of the Almanac chose a perfect image to communicate the same message. Here, in the privacy of a dark bedroom, the mother is transmitting what the patriarch calls maternal sensations and the charm of the Armenian language to her child. The mother desires for her language to be firmly and deeply planted so that the child is resistant to forgetting or to any future obliteration. It is very significant that this piece was published in 1930, which means that it was written probably in 1929. At the height of Citizen Speak Turkish campaign, foreign nationals as well as Turkish citizens were being harassed and punished for speaking languages other than Turkish in the streets, on ferries, in movie theaters, and other public spaces. Given this context, I argue that Patriarch's peace was a sign of Armenian resistance, with Armenian mothers at its center as the real heroes who could accomplish the goal of transmitting Armenianness to succeeding generations. I should also mention that arguably from the very days of the conception of Armenians as a nation, intellectuals emphasized the centrality of language to nationness. What is interesting here is the context in which this discourse is being reproduced and the form that it takes. The idea is old, it has been there for a long time, but it is appropriated here with a nuance. The same is true for the importance of religion, perceived as the second or arguably first. It's similarly important. It is seen as one of the most important defining and differentiating characteristics of Armenian ethnic identity in Turkey. This is a church in Cairo. Doesn't matter, I just put it as a symbol. We should remember that the Lausanne Treaty defined Armenians, along with Jews and Greeks, as a religious minority community protected by the Turkish state. According to the treaty, and despite the severe secularist policies of the early republic, non-Muslims were free to observe their religious rituals in their sanctuaries. This relative religious freedom made the church one of the key sites through which Turkish Armenians reconstructed and maintained national self-understanding and their differences from the majority. The church was considered a space within which to perform and share Armenianness without concern for potential intervention by the Turkish state. Significantly, the fact that Armenian communities worldwide attended the Armenian church every Sunday and on holidays made church attendance a diasporic moment. The church attendance at Armenian Christmas or Easter surpassed the boundaries of nation state and all other boundaries that separated Armenians from each other. Here's another example from the contemporary Armenian press from Haygin, an Armenian women's journal published in Istanbul. Literally, it is Armenian woman. On Armenian Christmas, January 6, 1924, 5 months after the ratification of the Treaty of Lausanne, Armenians in Istanbul filled the churches of the city to capacity. According to Haygan Uşmark, the editor of Haygin, everyone who went to the church that day felt a different sense of belonging and unity. She wrote, "To be fair, the church is a different thing for us. For other nations, it is a praying room where people practice their faith. For us, however, it is more than that. It is a mother with open arms. For the vagabond wrecks of our nation, in every country, it is an affectionate mother who attracts her wandering children. And she provides their souls with consolation through prayer, endless compassion, and weeping." Italics are mine. And this is a long quote, but I think it is worth it. for us, a nation dispersed to everywhere in the world, against the threat of dissolution and assimilation, the church is the most important place of refuge for self-preservation. For a nation like us that has such a bad faith, the highest happiness is to respect the religion and mother tongue. To my mind, and this is in 24, no patriarch, there's a vicar. Amongst the ups and downs of daily life, in a condition of this leaderless existence, and in the world of a quite painful everyday life, for our nation, there are only two savior channels, religion and mother tongue. Here, Mark casually links the scattered aspects of the Armenian nation or culture, the role of that scatteredness in the drive to preserve authentic Armenianness, and the significance of the woman's role in this process as in the idealized image of motherhood. Mark's likening of the church to a mother waiting with open arms is significant. She implies that the Armenian church is a space to which one belongs unconditionally. It is like a mother's lap. It is safe, secure, welcoming, always available, always ready to provide care. Similar to how children, regardless of external circumstances, belong to their mothers, Armenians, regardless of external circumstances, belong to the Armenian church, according to this text. Another important publication making a similar claim was Haykhosnak, Armenian spokesperson, which was the publication of the Armenian Apostolic Church. And similar to many other publications of the time, Haykhosnak put emphasis on Armenian schools as an indispensable element of Armenian identity in Turkey. One editorial in this monthly, which was otherwise similarly very pro-Turkish, read, "For a nation like ours, who during the course of long centuries had lost its opportunity to live freely and independently, the church and schools remain to be the uniquely indispensable factors of existence and self-determination. We should candidly admit that the community in Istanbul still has these two agencies that symbolize their nation, and they have to protect them at the cost of every possible sacrifice." And how about Norhus, arguably the most extreme example of dramatic endorsement of Turkification? I believe even Norhus fought back by trying to negotiate its own terms for an acceptable form of Armenianness in Turkey. The Weekly was highly interested in the condition of Armenian institutions, such as the Armenian National Hospital in Yedikule and the Para Society for the Relief of the Poor. In fact, 2 weeks before devoting its revenue to the Turkish Aeronautical Association, the Weekly had devoted its revenue to the Armenian hospital in celebration of its 103rd anniversary. This is it. Not surprisingly, the title of that day's cover page was not translated to Turkish. We might even speculate that after this declaration, Norhus was questioned by the Turkish Censorship Bureau for devoting its resources to an Armenian institution, which might explain why in 2 weeks' time the Weekly displayed loyalty to a Turkish institution, not only by channeling money, but also by providing a Turkish title. Norhus's selection of words denoting Armenian identity in Turkey is very telling. In the above-mentioned article, where Armenians are instructed how to become proper Turkish citizens, the word Hayrenagits is used, meaning those people who share the same patrida, fatherland. In another article where the Weekly reports in its cover page the 75th anniversary of the Para Society for the Relief of the Poor, it emphasizes that every Armenian Askayin and Tagaytsi must help this society. Askayin means national and Tagaytsi means a person of a specific neighborhood in Armenian. And it is very significant that Armenians kept, even after the Republic, Askayin to mean Armenian. I think this kind of elusive language shows that even Norhus tried to reproduce the idea that Armenians had multiple and equally valid identities and loyalties in Turkey. Now I will try to conclude. During the early Turkish Republic, the Turkish state and Turkish Armenians had opposing agendas, which can be broadly categorized as sameness versus difference. While the Turkish state was unwilling to incorporate ethnically hybrid identities into the category of Turk, Armenian public leaders and intellectuals strove for an essentially hybrid identity, a belonging that would allow them to be both Turkish and Armenian at the same time. In this kind of negotiation between two parties with asymmetric powers, Armenians expectedly played according to the rules of the rulers. Therefore, they presented themselves and became loyal Turkish citizens. They did not complain, at least publicly, about the discrimination they faced, and they did not ask for cultural and political rights on the basis of their ethno-cultural nationality, and even renounced some of their minority rights in 1925. At the same time, however, Turkish Armenians undermined the very aims of Turkification policies, that is ethnic homogenization, by creating a separate community for themselves, composed of Armenian families, schools, churches, and associations, and policing its boundaries through various textual and material strategies. They found ways and means to maintain their crucial differences from the majority. Assertions of Armenianness, such as mother tongue, religion, tradition, and to a certain extent, the memory of the recent massacres. In early Turkish Republic, even though Armenians were discouraged against using their native language in public, they could and did speak Armenian at home in the company of other Armenians. Although the state confiscated most of Armenian churches, Armenians, especially those in Istanbul, were free to practice their religion in the remaining churches. Hence, they married and baptized their children in the Armenian church. Although their schools were subject to scrutiny by the Turkish state officials, and though they were not allowed to teach Armenian history, they were allowed to teach and learn their language and literature at school. More importantly, I think, they had the right to get schooling together with other Armenians. Although their press was heavily censored, the existence of an Armenian press devoted to the community's matters was allowed. Although they were not allowed to use their Armenian last names, they were able to use Armenian first names, and they did, both in Istanbul and in Anatolia. By utilizing, if not exploiting, these kinds of small freedoms, Armenians have maintained their community to this day in Turkey. Thank you for listening.